be finishing Wednesday's lecture. On Wednesday, we only went through half of the lecture, so I'll finish the rest of the lecture online. So on Wednesday, we finished talking about transgenic plants, those GMO plants. And now we talk about transgenic animals. So we developed different methods to help to insert so-called foreign gene, or the gene that we are interested in, into the eggs of the animal. So that after that, the animal, the newborn will have the gene that we are interested in, so that the newborn can produce the product that we want to harvest. For example, if we insert the gene for ovine growth hormone into animal, then we can get a larger animal, because these offspring, they will have this hormone that will boost their growth. The exact techniques, as you can read that, it is kind of complicated. We don't need to know the exact details how to do it, but we'll show you different ways in the next few slides about with the pictures, so that you know the basic steps of making transgenic animals. So gene farming or transgenic farm animal, this is another, other than inserting the hormone gene into animals so that they will grow bigger and produce more meat, we can also insert gene that can produce pharmaceuticals such as milk, a different kind of protein, a special kind of protein that we can find in the milk of the animal. And not only that, the goal is that the protein, special protein that can be using this gene farming, using these techniques, we hope to produce protein that will help to treat different diseases. So this is the schematic sequence for making transgenic animal. So the first step is to, for example, the growth hormone, human growth hormone. Let's say we are interested for the animal to make this human growth hormone. Then we get the gene from the human being, and then we inject it to the usually it takes a while, because after we inject the human gene into the nucleus, it will take a while for the egg to incorporate the human gene into the donor gene, the animal gene. And after that, we put the egg into a host animal, another animal, so that this animal can grow the egg. So that the animal can develop the eggs. Of course, we need to have a sperm donor as well, so that the sperm can fertilize the egg, and then you have an animal born that has the human growth hormone gene. This animal that has a human growth hormone, it will produce the milk that has human growth hormone. When this animal sexually mature, it will continue to produce all this egg that has the human growth hormone gene, the green dot in the nucleus. The green dot in the nucleus means that it has the human growth hormone gene. step here, what happens is that we have another donor of the egg, but what happens is that we call it enucleated eggs. Enucleated eggs meaning that the donor donated eggs, but we remove the nucleus of the eggs and then we put in the nucleus of the previous transgenic goat into this egg. Yeah, so we take the egg of another goat and then get the remove the nucleus and then we insert the nucleus from previous animal into here. And then we put the egg in the different host goat and then they can form different transgenic goat again. In this case we get more of the goat. You may ask, how come we do it two different methods? How come at the beginning we do the injection and then we do it this way? And then after that, how come we don't do the same thing but take another egg, take eggs from another animal, but then we do the enucleation, that means removing the egg. We are removing the nucleus from the eggs and then put in the nucleus from the previous one. Why do we do it differently? The main reason is that for this original step, for this original method, it is very difficult. The success rate is not that high. That's why maximum they can get one or two animals that works. After we make the first transgenic goat, then we can use this method. It's simpler and they can. It is not only simpler, higher success rate, and also they can produce more of the transgenic eggs. More transgenic eggs, then that means they more goat can be fertilized by these transgenic eggs. So it is the first one is always the most difficult. After you get the first one done, then the rest of them is easier. That's why milk can have a human growth hormone. Yeah, not only goat but also cow and other the milk that we buy from the supermarket. Now gene therapy. Gene therapy is basically a similar concept. We insert a gene into human cells so that hopefully we can treat or reverse the genetic disorder and other diseases. There are different methods to insert a gene into human cells. Unlike the one that it is well for transgenic animal, we learn that okay, we can use the carbine needle or to insert the human gene into the nucleus, and after this we do the enucleation, removing the nucleus, so on and so forth. But for human cell, we use different way. One is that we use virus. The reason is that virus can carry it is, as you know that okay, when we get a flu or cold, it is because of viral infection. We take advantage of the virus that is very potent, they are very good at infecting or carry the genetic material we take advantage of this property of virus that they are very infectious, so that they can carry the gene into different host cell, into different body cell. So we insert the interested genetic material into virus and then let virus to carry that interested gene into human cell. Another way is the liposomes. Liposomes is just a droplet of lipids. It's just a small droplet of lipids. And because it is a small droplet of lipid, that's why it can go through the phospholipid bilayer of the cell membrane and also the phospholipid bilayer of the nuclear envelope. Because of that, we can put the interested gene into the liposome, a small droplet of oil of lipid, And then this liposome can go through both the cell membrane and the nuclear envelope, and then you can carry that interesting gene into the DNA inside the nucleus. Sometimes the gene is injected directly into the specific region of the body. We'll give you an example of a cystic fibrosis, how we do it. And in USC, there's a professor, Don Arnold. He has something called a gene gun. He basically shoots the gene material into the cell that he wants, so that he uses gold particle. The gold particle coated with the gene that he's interested in, and then he just shoots it. The gold particle will go directly right into the nucleus. Yeah, that's how he transfer the gene that he's interested in. He calls his method a gene gun. Ex vivo gene therapy. We use ex vivo. Ex vivo, that means it is outside of the body. Ex vivo meaning outside of the living body. So SCID, severe combined immunodeficiency. So the when a person develops this SCID, then they do not have this enzyme ADA, adenosine deaminase. This ADA is for maturation of T cell and B cell. T cell and B cell, they are some of the immune cell. For example, B cell, mature B cell will secrete antibody to fight infection. T cell has many different types of T cell. One type is called one type of T cell. They act like a skull, meaning that they look for infection or foreign material, microbe. So when this T cell see the foreign invader in our body, then it will signify other white blood cell and B cell to fight the infection. So when children, they do not have ADA, then the T cell and B cell cannot mature. When T cell and B cell cannot mature, that means they cannot form antibody, and they cannot detect foreign invader. In this case, it is very easy for them to die because of infection. So we try to use this method to treat this SCID. The steps are actually, of course, a lot more complicated than this, but we simplify it here. First thing is to get the stem cell from the bone marrow. Why is that? So we use the virus to infect the bone marrow stem cell. As I mentioned before, virus is very good at infecting a cell. But the virus carry the normal gene. Normal gene, that means the normal gene for enzyme ADA. Why? Because for SCID, the kid, they do not have the enzyme ADA. So we give the virus the normal gene for ADA, then the virus will carry this normal gene to infect the bone marrow from the kid, bone marrow stem cells, and after the stem cell are being infected by the virus that carry the normal ADA gene, then we re-implant the stem cells back to the kids and hope that the stem cell that carries the ADA gene can start to work and survive. It can survive and start to divide and develop into the in the patient's body. And hopefully, those stem cells can make ADA, so that it will help the maturation of T cell and B cell. Another example for this ex vivo gene therapy is a hypercholesterolemia. This condition we talk about when we talk about the chromosome disorder, it is one of the chromosome disorder. What remember in the one of the chromosome disorder we talk about is that for people with this condition, the cell membrane, they do not have the receptor for the LDL. And here it said that the liver cell do not have the receptor for LDL. So usually the patient, they have a very high LDL level, so that the kids, let's say it is as young as 2 years old, they may have a they may experience heart attack. So what happened is that part of the liver is being surgically removed, and then again we use virus that contain the normal gene for the receptor, meaning that there's a receptor expressed on the surface of the liver cell that they can take in, they can bind the LDL. So the virus contains the normal gene for this receptor that can bind LDL, and then we use the virus to infect the liver, the portion of the liver that we remove from the liver. After the virus infected the liver, then we graft the portion of the liver back to the body. And because it is the same body, so there will be no rejection. Hopefully, this part of the liver can start to make the receptor to bind the LDL. So all these are the examples of using ex vivo gene therapy, and you do not need to memorize all of them. You do not need to memorize them. The only one that you need to know is the liver one, the one for the hypercholesterolemia. And also the one that we talk about, SCID, from the bone marrow. And it talks a lot about cancer, you know, cancer and tumor. Those, well, they are not, well, they may or may not work. I would say the success rate should be low. Otherwise, I mean, they will not be called cancer. But we try to do that. And another one you need to pay attention is this cystic fibrosis. We use the gene transfer by aerosol spray that we will talk about it now. We'll talk about it pretty soon. So this is the schematic diagram for what we just talked about. For example, the SCID, severe combined immunodeficiency. SCID. So what happened is that we removed the stem cell from the bone marrow, and then of course they have a defective gene. That means they cannot make the ADA, adenosine, deaminase. There, they cannot make that enzyme. The enzyme ADA that is for maturation of the T cell and B cell. What happened is that we use a virus that carries the normal ADA gene. You see that it is a darker red here. And then we use this virus, because virus, they only have RNA, they only carry RNA. So this is an RNA gene that goes in the virus. And then virus will infect the stem cells, so that the RNA from the virus here. Then there's something called reverse transcription. Remember transcription and translation? Transcription is basically converting DNA into RNA, messenger RNA. So we call it reverse transcription, meaning that the cell will convert the RNA into DNA. After the cell convert RNA back into DNA, then this piece of DNA, hopefully, it can incorporate into the main the main DNA inside the nucleus. And then we will return this stem cell back to the body. Hopefully this stem cell can start to make the ADAM enzyme to mature the T cell and B cell. And as you can see that this part, incorporation of the DNA to the stem cell DNA, this part is kind of risky, it's kind of tricky. So that is the part that can affect the success rate of this gene therapy. So now we talk about the cystic fibrosis. Cystic fibrosis, because they lack the gene that code for chloride transporter protein. We will talk more about this different kinds of ion channel or ion transporter when we talk about nervous system. Basically, in the cell, we have the transporter protein so that the different ion can go into or out of the cell. Because of the defective of this transporter protein, chloride transporter protein, a thick mucus is developed in the lung, leading to infection of the respiratory tract. The thick mucus can trap lots of bacteria and germ. But the thing is that the mucus is so thick that our lung or trachea cannot get rid of it. So the bacteria and the microbes, they will just keep growing in that mucus, causes infection. And that is the cystic fibrosis. So what happens is that we use an aerosol spray that carry the gene for this chloride transporter protein. The normal gene for this chloride transporter protein, we spray it into the nose, and hopefully the spray can go into the respiratory tract as well. And the spray contains also a virus, we call it adenovirus. As you know, the virus, they are very good at infecting the cell. So this adenovirus carry the normal gene for this chloride transport protein. So we spray it, basically the patient is voluntarily infected by this virus that carry the normal chloride transporter protein. Or it's a virus, they use a liposomes. So it's either virus or liposome. Hopefully, the cell in the respiratory tract, they can get the normal normal gene for this transporter protein. And if the cell in the respiratory tract get this normal gene of the transporter protein, we hope that the nucleus can incorporate this normal gene so that they can the thick mucus will be eliminated, because they will start having the normal chloride transporter protein. But the truth is that the success is limited, as you can tell that there are lots of steps that it is kind of risky. Theoretically that can work, but practically a lot of variation can occur. And of course, we want to use it for cancer treatment. One of the goals is to make the healthy cell more tolerant of the chemotherapy. As you know, the chemotherapy is basically administering toxin or poison to kill the theoretically to kill the cancer cell. But when we administer the toxin or poison, it also kills the healthy cell. So the goal of the gene therapy is to make the healthy cell more resistant to the drug or the poison or toxin, so that the chemotherapy will only kill the cancer cell. Or another way is that to make the tumor cell more sensitive to the drug, to the poison or the toxin. So it's like we are adjusting the push-pull factor. So hope by making the healthy cell more tolerant, or by making the tumor cell more sensitive, or sometimes we hope that we can do both. to maximize the benefit. But it's just, well, if it really works, then as I said, that it won't be called cancer. So genomics, proteomics, and bioinformatics, which is the last three topics that we'll talk about tonight. Genomics. Genomics is, this is the definition of genomics, is the study of the complete genetic sequences of human and other organisms. So this is the number you need to memorize, 3.2 billion bases in human genome. Meaning that if you take a cell from a human and then you look at the nucleus and all the genes, all the base pairing, that means you know the ATGC, all 46 chromosomes, they have all 46 chromosomes together, they have 3.2 billion of bases. So this is the number that you need to memorize, 3.2 billion bases. But majority of the 98%, they are non-coding, meaning that they do not code for any protein. And many of them contain repetitive sequences. We call it telomeres. One of the repetitive sequences, we call it telomeres, and then previous one, another repetitive sequence we talk about is called the short sequence. We talk about it on Wednesday. This short tandem repeat. Short tandem repeat is the one that we talk about on Wednesday, and then today we will talk about the telomeres a little bit. So the repetitive sequences, we talk about the short tandem repeat. Tonight we talk about the telomeres. And then the first step is to know the sequencing of the base in the genomes. Sequencing it, nowadays we can do it by machine, which is pretty quick and efficient. But since we have 3.2 billion of bases, it still takes some time. And the second step is to map the location of the gene on the chromosome. And in the next few slides, it will tell you how many genes that we have mapped so far. Oh, here we already told you, we have 21,000 of genes. We have 21,000 of genes for proteins. So Human Genome Project, many of you may have heard about this term, Human Genome Project. It's a 13-year effort that involved both university and private. The first human was being seen was a woman. Yeah, she volunteered that before she died. And again, we have 3.2 billion of DNA bases. And originally, it takes a long time, 13 years, to sequence the first human volunteer. Later on, as the technology improves, it gets faster and faster. It says that there's a frog, African claw frog, sequenced in less than 1 year. In less than 1 year, we finished sequencing the entire frog. So when people are doing the Human Genome Project, they discover something called a single nucleotide polymorphism. Single nucleotide polymorphism, SNP. So what happened is that for example, when they compare the same gene between individual or between animals, we may have the same gene, we share actually many genes, let's say with chimpanzee or even mice. We share many genes, the same gene with mice and chimpanzee, But the thing is that even though it is the same gene, they may have one nucleotide differences between even though it is the same gene. They found that if it is one nucleotide different, many of them they have no effect. But a few of them they have the differences, protein-protein differences. What happened is that when the SNP single nucleotide polymorphism occur, some of it may affect to the disease or response to medical treatment. So it may lead to disease or it may lead to the sensitivity to different medical treatment. That's why we come up with a term called designer drug to tailor to the individual genotype. Because some people, they may have one nucleotide different. That make them, they may not be responsive to certain drug treatment. Then we have to use different one to fit their genome. So previous slides, we said that we have a 21,000 gene. Here we said 23,000 gene. So you can may approximate 21 to 23,000 genes. We have two types of genomics, structural genomics and functional genomics. We'll talk about that in detail at the end of the slides. Structural genomics, as the name suggested, we want to know the sequence of the bases and how many genes we have. Functional is just that what does it do? What does the gene code for? Most of the genes expect to code for protein, but it's not necessary. In later of the slides, I'll tell you the new definition of gene. It's not necessary. We do not define gene as the part that will express protein. Some non-coding or junk DNA, for example, the intron. Remember intron? In the transcription translations online lecture, I'll talk about intron. The intron and the non-coding DNA, they may have important function that we'll talk about it also later in the slides. So genomic architecture. Most of the human genome, they are DNA that do not code for anything. It seems that they do not code for amino acids, they do not code for protein. But how come? Because some of the non-coding DNA they code for RNA, remember RNA, ribosomal RNA, tRNA, transfer RNA. We talk about these two in the online lecture about transcription and translation. Yes, they are for protein synthesis. And for those of the genome that is not for RNA, that is not transcribed for RNA and tRNA, some of them they are repeated. They are repeated sequence. I told you before, telomeres that we'll talk about later today. And then there are some part of the element, they are very interesting. One is called transposable element or transposon. So they said that 44% of the human genome, they are transposon. What is transposon? Transposon, also known as the jumping gene. Jumping genes, they act like virus, literally. They can move by themselves in the genome. In other words, if you think about it, if certain part of the gene, they can move by itself, so it can potentially cause mutation. And yes, it can cause mutation, but because they are moving, Like that, they can also repair any DNA damage or repair mutation as well. So you can think about it this way. If too much of the jumping gene, too much of the transposon go into exon, let's say exon, then it can potentially change the protein expressed by that exon, which may or may not be good. As I said, that the transfer and the jumping gene, they can repair or they can damage the gene product. And it was discovered by a female scientist, Barbara McClintock. I believe she was from Cold Spring Harbor Lab as well. And it was interesting. She discovered it a long time ago in 1950, and then she published it in some kind of obscure journal that no one cares about it. No one read it. But then later on, I don't remember which one. I heard there is some kind of a hotshot, big shot scientist. They discovered the transposon, transferable element, and they make a big news. They thought that they're the first one who discovered it, and they know that it's an important discovery, and they know that they will get Nobel Prize. But unfortunately, all the scientists found out that Barbara McClintock was actually the first one who discovered it. So yes, they make a big news. They try to advertise for themselves. All the credit went to Barbara McClintock, so she got the Nobel Prize for that. And then because of the part of the gene, they can move around, so it causes, basically, it is a driving force for the evolution. Remember evolution? We'll talk about evolution. So this weekend's online lecture is talk about the microevolution. So we'll start talking about evolution in the next few, on next Wednesday, and also on the Friday online lecture as well. So you know that mutation is actually the source of the new gene, the ultimate source of the new gene for the evolution. We have a repetitive DNA element. So other than the transposon, we have this, we call it the telomeres. So what is telomeres? So at the end of a piece of gene, usually they have something called telomeres. Telomeres is like it caps the end of the, actually not the end of gene, the chromosome. It is the end of a chromosome. We have this telomeres. What happens is that during DNA replication, the end of each chromosome is basically a very long sequence of DNA, the end of the chromosome will be shortened. When it's shortened, it is the telomere, the repeated sequence, is getting shortened. As you can think about it this way, the cell goes through the DNA replication in the S phase during the normal cell cycle. What happens is that during the normal cell cycle, every time it goes through the DNA replication, the S phase, then part of the telomere will be shortened. And it is good because if the chromosome, every time it replicates, it will shorten, then the telomere is basically protecting the DNA in the chromosome from being removed. But as you can imagine, as we get older and older and older, after our cell go through many, many times of S phase or DNA replication, and the telomere is getting shortened every time we do it, and as we get older and older, then when the telomere disappear because of all the shortening or during our lifetime, then if we continue to go through the S phase to DNA, for the replication of DNA, then the shortening will go into the exon and intron. That means it will truncate or cut the gene that is responsible for expressing protein, and that truncating the useful part of the DNA will potentially cause a mutation, or it may potentially cause a cancer. That's why when a cell is getting old or aged, then usually our body has somehow a mechanism to destroy it. For example, by the lysosome can destroy the damaged DNA, damaged organelles. You said that it still has an unknown function. And then other than transposon and repetitive DNA, we have also sequence that we don't know the function.